evening, everyone. Thank you very much, sir, for this introduction, and thanks thanks to the organizers for giving me this opportunity to speak at this platform. I have taken up a very small area as far as India and Southeast Asia and the cultural connectivity is concerned. It's the culinary link between India and Southeast Asia. It's a new area. I've never worked much on Southeast Asia. However, yes, I've worked regarding the cultural connectivity between India and other parts of the world. And to start off with the culinary link, I am just reminded of this quote, which was professor in the US of Indian origin, Kia Ganguly. She said that it is difficult, if not impossible, immigrant Indian existence in the United States without at the same time thinking of Indian food. Now, this is something I feel it is universally applicable as far as Indian diaspora is concerned, Indian migrants are concerned across the world. Wherever Indian diaspora is there, Indian migrants are there, Indian food has inevitably traveled with them, at times giving rise to new cultures, at times it's used as a symbol to preserve one's own culture and so on. So, roots of diaspora communities are in antiquity, and since ages they have been the torch bearers of the culture of their home state in numerous ways. One of the, on one hand, this led to the preservation of culture, and on the other, it gave birth to new amalgamated cultures. In Indian environments, as these communities struggle to gain acceptance and foothold, leaving behind the familiar, traditional food is the thread which keeps them and their second generation children connected with their homeland. As one of the scholars working on culinary history, Ray calls diaspora the unconscious habit which becomes visible and audible due to displacement. Diasporas have been the carriers of cuisine since time immemorial. People and food habits are like Siamese twins, and thus the latter is the easiest cultural export of any state. Cuisine today has become synonymous with communities, culture, tradition, hybridity, soft power, multiculturalism, and so on. Indian diasporic narratives in the West speak of sentiments like dilemmas. They talk about debates and stigmas, which are attached with the gastronomic delights of Indian cuisine. Whereas non-diasporic works in the West, primarily in popular culture, films like Indiana Jones, Temple of Doom, TV programs like Sex and the City, The Devil Wears Prada, etc., have very often ridiculed the Indian cuisine. The assertion of the chicken tikka masala to be British made few briefly optimistic about Indian cuisine finding acceptance in the Western states. But soon of culinary metaphors to characterize Indian diaspora was a short-lived trend before triggering off controversies. However, it did reflect the importance of food and sensitivity it carried in Indian culture. In Southeast Asia, Indian food perfectly blended with the local cuisines and other cuisines and had reached there with the migrants from places like, which had reached there, migrant China. Many recipes retained their originality, whereas others had to be modified due to unavailability of ingredients. In such cases, locally available replaced the India, giving rise to hybrid cuisines. This paper investigates the history of Indian cuisine in Southeast Asia and how the diaspora community has successfully preserved its essence so far. The Indian diaspora in Southeast Asia has a long history. The earliest migration from South Asia to Southeast century BC, the period of King Ashoka, he sent Buddhist monks to propagate Buddhism in Indo-Chinese Peninsula. From South India, migration between India and Malaysian Peninsula can be traced back to the Chola period. In the colonial age, particularly after 1840, around millions of Indians moved to the growing cities and plantations in Southeast Asia. Migrants had set out in search of livelihood or to escape conditions at home during the colonial age. over the ages, Indians who migrated carried their food habits and ended up, ended up influencing the cuisines in these states where they settled down. India, which has been known for its spices, influenced the cuisine in Southeast Asia with its spices. Today, this region offers a perfect blend of Chinese, Indian, and local cuisines. And thus, what we have today is Indian, Indonesian cuisine, Malaysian Indian cuisine, Singaporean Indian cuisine, and so on. Indian spices were very well received in Southeast Asia as it made their food more flavorful. One of the evident influence is the use of banana leaf to serve and eat food in Southeast Asia. The Hindus from the Indian state of Tamil Nadu who migrated to Southeast Asia brought the culture with them, and today traditional local cuisines are also served on the banana leaf. The second evident influence is in case of beverages consumed in Southeast Asia. So a popular beverage is Teh Tarik, or which is the milk tea, which was brought by the Indian Muslim migrants in Southeast Asia. So prior to the Second World War, the Indian Muslim migrants in parts of Malaysia and Singapore used to was taken by the colonial rulers. However, after the Second World War, it was difficult and expensive to purchase tea leaves. Tea drinking in general became a luxurious activity exclusive to the wealthy. As such, most laborers were unable to drink tea they once loved. They began to experiment with other methods to recreate their tea beverages. The British would buy only the best quality tea leaves. Seeing this, the Indian Muslim migrants brought the discarded tea leaves from processing ground into powdery tea, thus to make their tea. They would even boil the tea at a palace to save on cost. As a result, the taste of the tea would often get too bitter or astringent. Thus, they decided to add condensed milk or evaporated milk with sugar. So tea continues to be a popular beverage both in India and in Southeast Asia till date. Or rather, in Southeast Asia, it's Teh Tarik. Further, pickles, which often accompany a lot of local food in Southeast Asia, again has roots from India. Apart from this, in particular, the impact of cuisines from South India is evident. And in this case, specifically the cuisine of the Mamak community, which is a Muslim community originally from Kerala. The Mamak community in Southeast Asia eats Indian Muslim dishes, which are a mix of Indian and Malay cuisine, and are served at Mamak restaurants and stalls throughout the day and well into the night, which makes them a popular place to eat and hang out, to watch late night cooking. And restaurants sell Indian dishes like roti kanai, which or nasi kandar, which is primarily the chicken curry served with steamed rice. Now, nasi here means rice, while the Malay verb kandar is the act of carrying things across the shoulder. This dish was invented by Indian Muslim South India who are during the colonial rule in search of better opportunities. In past years, Tamil Muslim merchants who migrated to Malaysia would sell bags. They used to sell and transport this dish using bamboo sticks that buckets weighing the food, either using Indian spices like cinnamon and star anise. Another popular dish in the Mamak stalls or restaurants is pasimbol, a vegetable salad believed to be of Indian origin. It is Mamak rujak in Malaysia or rujak in Indonesia, and that's Indian rujak in Singapore. Precisely when or where these Penang based Indian Muslims invented pasimbol is unclear, but still it is associated, its roots are traced to India. Another popular dish which recently made ways into Southeast Asia was Maggi Goreng. Now, Maggi is a popular noodle brand in India. And in Southeast Asia, when it is prepared, it's a blend of Indian and Chinese cooking practices, culinary practices and masalas which they use. So again, it's a blend of culture that we see emerging. Apart from this, murtabak is another dish brought to Southeast Asia by the Tamil Muslims. And it is a multi-layered pancake whose origins are traced to the Indian state of Kerala, where the Arab traders had actually bought it. So murtabak, sorry, is the original name of the dish. And murtabak is an amalgam of two words, muta, mean being the Malayali word for egg, a significant component of the dish, and bar, or the abbreviated form of the word parota, or paratha, or roti, that is the bread. The Singapore version of murtabak are a combination of Arab and Indian flavors, spices, and cooking techniques. Another popular dish brought by the Tamil Muslims was nasi biryani, which again was brought to the Indian state of Kerala by the Arab traders, and later the Tamil Muslim migrants brought it to Singapore. Another variant of biryani, which is consumed in Indonesia as well, is nasi kebuli. And scholars trace its origin to Kabuli Pulao from Afghanistan. The Indonesian variant displays influence of Hadrami and Indian cuisine, such as mandi and biryani, in the cooking methods and seasoning. Among the popular hybrid dishes is laksa, which is essentially a noodle soup. This dish manifests a blend of Indian, Chinese, and Singaporean culture. Origins of the name laksa are uncertain. However, many trace it to the Hindi word laksaha, a term used to refer to a type of vermicelli. Laksaha, in turn, may be derived from Sanskrit lakhas, meaning 100 to the noodle cake when dry. It has also been is lysa, literally meaning spicy sand, alluding to the ground dried prawns used in the soup, which gives laksa sandy or gritty texture. A variant of this dish is asa, being prepared using coconut milk. Its broth is made from fish, tamarind, and torch ginger flower. Torch ginger flower is a spectacular edible bloom common throughout Southeast Asia. Fragrant roots are blended to form spice paste, which adds punchy flavor to the broth when thoroughly. The garnish of pineapple, cucumber, and mint, and helps cut through the broth. Whilst originating in Penang, this laksa is particularly popular in Kuala Lumpur. And again, as like the name suggests, its roots are again traced back to India. Another popular dish is gulai, which is another hybrid dish. Be the local adaptation of the Indian curry, developed and derived from Indian influence on Indonesian cuisine. The ingredients used in the dish many Indian roots. The thick and the yellowish gulai sauce is one of the most Gapu cuisine, which is the cuisine of West Sumatra, to give a rich and spicy taste to meats, fish, or vegetables. In Malaysia, Assam Peda is a version of Malay popular sour fish soup, times called. In Perak and Pahang, Gulai Tempoyak, a local speciality, is commonly served either for daily meals or during festive celebrations such as Hari Raya and wedding ceremonies. In some towns, roti also be served with gulai instead of a curry. The gulai sauce found in Menang, Gabau, Aceh, and Malay cuisine usually has a thicker consistency, while gulai in Java is thinner, served in soup-like dishes. Gulai is usually served with steamed rice also here. The popular fish head invented by Goan origin was from India. The head of the red snapper is stewed in this dish in a Kerala-style curry with assorted vegetables such as okra and eggplants or brinjal. It is usually served with either rice or bread or as a shared dish. Although in India, fish head was not used, but in Singapore, the Chinese migrants considered it to be a delicacy, thus again giving rise to a hybrid cuisine. Similarly, the popular in East Asia made of mashed potatoes, peas, and meat is a variant of the Goan keema that is consumed till date. Fish mooli is another such dish of Goan origin. The British colonial rulers also brought mulai, peppery curry soup derived from the Tamil rasam. With the Anglo-Indians, the chicken wrap also made its way to Southeast Asia. And with the growing migrants from North India, even the vegetarian variant of this dish made its way to Southeast Asia. There are also many other Indian foods or dishes which are less widely available in Southeast Asia, but which can still be found in several areas serving a more specifically Indian clientele. These include dishes like appam, bhatura, chutney, sambar, idli, muruku, puttu, mayam, samosa, tandoori, dosa, upma, jalebi, and so. Some of these again reached with the migrants in the past, and some came with the migrants in the recent or contemporary times. The beauty of the influence of Indian cuisine in Southeast Asia is that it has perfectly blended with the local cuisines. At times it gave birth to new dishes, at times it's as a symbol of culture, of Indian culture. Unlike the Western states where Indian cuisine found it difficult to find a following or to find acceptance, in Southeast Asia it easily amalgamated with the culture and the culinary practices. Indian food and its influence in Southeast Asia is not about attaining or exercising power, but it is an epitome of how food brings people and civilizations together, giving birth to several new cultures. In other words, it's a manifestation of how cultural practices can coexist. At the same time, I would just conclude by saying, like the punchline of the popular coffee chain in India, Cafe Coffee Day, a lot can happen over a cup of coffee. Therefore, a much more can happen over a meal. Perhaps culinary history of both the regions can be a bridge in bringing states in these regions together and giving birth to new alliances, new cultures, new friendships and
stuff. Another 5 minutes. I don't speak for another 5 minutes.
Sir, I'm done. I'm through with speaking.
Now, from the audience, since you've heard a lot of cuisines and